Professor Francione, Professor Gary Francione, and Professor Anna Charlton, law professors at Rutgers University. They co-founded the law clinic there, and Professor Francione is the first academic to teach animal rights theory in an American law school at Rutgers University. They are co-authors, well, the latest book from Professors Gary Francione and Anna Charlton, Animal Rights, the Abolitionist Approach. This is the latest available for sale here this weekend. And the one just before this, Eat Like You Care, which is an examination of the morality of eating animals, which has been translated into many languages. So, right? How many languages do you think it was?
12
languages. So please welcome Professor Gary Francione and Professor Anna Charlton. I believe that there is anyone who would credibly say, or could credibly say, that eating animal products is good for your health or necessary for your health. That's really the point in many ways. It's not a question, no one can say that eating animals is necessary for optimal health. I think the evidence, and many other people think the evidence is compelling, that eating animal products is detrimental to human health. But you don't even have to go that far in the argument. The point is, it is not necessary to eat animal products. In every major professional organization and governmental organization maintains that a vegan diet is perfectly healthy. So I don't want to talk about health. I don't want to talk about the environment. I think the evidence is fairly clear that a vegan diet, or I'm sorry, animal agriculture is destroying the planet. What we want to talk about today is morality. Those are all the organizations that say basically a vegan diet is perfectly healthy for you. So this idea that, you know, you're going to die, your eyes are going to, you know, your arms and legs are going to fall off, you're going to go blind if you're vegan. Nonsense. You know, we've been, Anna and I have been vegans since October of 1982, okay? And we ain't dead yet. So, you know, I mean, this idea that veganism isn't healthy is ridiculous. Animal agriculture, ecological disaster, you want to talk about veganism as a moral principle, okay. Veganism is not a matter of compassion or mercy. I would love to see the word compassion in this context exit the English language. I find it offensive. It is not a matter of compassion. It is not a matter of mercy. If animals matter morally, if they are not things, then being vegan is something that we must do. If you're not a vegan, you're participating actively in animal exploitation. Okay? Abolitionists reject all exploitation, even supposedly humane exploitation. We take the position that we have no choice. If we take animal rights seriously, if we believe that animals have moral value at all, it is our position that we must be principled and consistent vegans. We see veganism as a rejection of the status of non-human animals as commodities. We're going to talk about this tomorrow, about the idea that animals are property. Animals don't matter. They have no inherent value. They have no intrinsic value. They only have the extrinsic, external value that they have as chattel property, as slaves once did. They have no value other than external, extrinsic value as chattel, as things. We believe that veganism is a rejection of the status of animals as commodities. We see it as a fundamental principle of justice. It's unfair to treat animals as replaceable resources and deny them the one right we accord all humans, irrespective of particular characteristics. What do I mean by that? What I mean is, we all recognize, whatever our position on various human rights are concerned, whether we're liberal, whether we're conservative, doesn't matter. We all reject human slavery. We all see slavery as something that is separate and apart from other forms of discrimination. That doesn't mean it doesn't exist. Slavery does exist in the world. Slavery is a serious problem. Nobody defends it. Everybody recognizes that chattel slavery is a particularly insidious, obscene form of human rights violations. Why? Because you take humans and you move them completely outside the moral and legal community. You treat them as things. So we recognize that all humans, irrespective of their characteristics, irrespective of whether they're smart or whether they're not smart, or whether they're beautiful or whether they're not, whatever, whether they're really intelligent, it doesn't matter. Irrespective of their characteristics, we recognize that all humans have and must have, if they are to be members of the moral and legal community, they must have one right, the right not to be property. Okay? And so what we say is non-humans have exactly that one same right. But recognizing that one same right means you must abolish, not regulate, abolish all forms of institutionalized animal exploitation, all of which depend on the property status of animals. Okay? Now, we see veganism as an act of nonviolent defiance, as a refusal to participate in the oppression of the innocent and the vulnerable. Look, if we're going to ever have a movement, we've got to get rid of this idea that any consumption of animal products, eating them, wearing them, using them, is normal. We've got to get rid of that. One of the things, you know, a number of people have come up to me and said, what do you think about this lab meat, you know, this in vitro meat? And the thing is, look, first of all, anybody who tells you that it doesn't involve harming animals is lying to you. It does involve harming animals. But the bottom line is, why do we have to reinforce this idea again and again and again and again and again that if we don't have meat on the plate, if we don't have animal food, we're somehow being deprived? We need to shift the paradigm. We need to get away from the idea that food is stuff that comes from sentient beings. We've got to get, you know, we've got to start thinking about food as fruits, vegetables, seeds, you know, beans, things like that. No animal products at all. We've got to get away from the idea that any of this is normal. It's not. Okay. All right. Let me just move on here a little bit. Yes. You want to live a nonviolent life? Being a vegan is not all you need to do. That's for sure. You need to go a lot further. The idea, you know, if you care about nonviolence, then you've got to go further than being a vegan, but you got to be a vegan. If you are talking words of nonviolence while you are shoveling the products of violence into your mouth or wearing them, you are being hypocritical, okay? So you need to see that nonviolence means, at the very least, being vegan. It means more, but it can't mean less. All right, now to the extent practicable, you can't avoid all of it. You're sitting on chairs. I'm quite sure that there are animal products, you know, used in the processing, in probably the fabrics that you're sitting on right now. You have computers. The plastics have animal products. The thing is, you can't escape the roads. Road surfaces have bovine blood in them. So you can't avoid it completely. Okay? Because these products are so cheap, the slaughterhouse products are so cheap that they're there and they will be used in manufacturing things. So you can't avoid that, but what a vegan is a person who avoids it to the extent practicable. It means every time you got a choice, you choose not to exploit. Okay? Which means, you know, doesn't mean you can't sit on the chairs. You're all sitting on chairs. I don't suggest you sit on the floor. I don't suggest you not have computers. It just means when you have a choice, which you all do, when you eat, when you buy your next pair of shoes, when you buy your next pair of pants, whatever you buy, when you buy your next bottle of shampoo, you have a choice. Just don't buy death. Don't buy violence. Don't participate in the slavery of non-human animals. Okay. It's also there's something that I want to say, but you know, a lot of people think that being a vegan is coextensive with like everything that is good in the world. So they say, well, you know, you can't be a vegan and be in favor of war. And the answer is, I'm sorry, I'm not in favor of war. But as a matter of fact, I'm violently opposed to violence. But I think that you know, somebody can be not opposed to war and still be a vegan. Being a vegan doesn't mean, you know, you agree with everything good and it's not, you know, it just means basically to the extent practicable, you do not eat, wear, or use animals or participate in animal exploitation. You don't go to circuses, you don't go to zoos, you don't go, you know, you just don't participate in that stuff. You know, I'd like to think that you know, that people want to go further, but, you know, look, there are, there are Republicans who are good vegans. It's true. So, you know, it doesn't, you know, okay. Shoot, vegetarianism is the gateway.
Oh, okay. Well, we often hear that, you know, we need to advocate for vegetarianism because, of course, veganism is just so difficult, and turning to a vegetarian diet will be a gateway to converting people to veganism. I don't see a lot of history that has worked. It hasn't worked efficiently, and it isn't a necessary way of getting to veganism. I meet so many 20, you know, veterans of 20 years of vegetarianism who said, I'm vegan now, and I can't understand why I haven't been vegan for 19 years and 9 months, and it's come down to no one asked if I thought it was a good idea, that people settled for my vegetarianism. And I think that's something that we need to have a clear message. If you don't ask people to entertain the idea that they can become vegan, they will settle for less. It's human nature, both in terms of information and human nature. So am I just pressing this one to get down? There we are, okay. And that vegetarianism is, as I'm sure many of you already realized, a totally incoherent moral position. If I said I eat the flesh of black and white cows, but I don't eat the flesh of those cute little brown Jersey cows, would you think I was thinking rationally? I don't think so. Anyone who knows anything about the egg industry, anyone who knows anything about the horrors of the dairy industry, can't think that because you're not eating the final product that comes out of that poor body, that you are excused from the responsibility for all the suffering that goes on in the other parts of the industry. It's hard for us, for the vegans, I'm sure, in the audience to look back and think how we thought about that. But if we all think of everyone we meet as pre-vegans, aspiring vegans, right? We're not special in that way. We're not a superior group of people. We don't have higher analytical skills. We're not more ethical. We just have been introduced to this. So I meet pre-vegans all the time. I think that's often a good way to make more vegans. Okay, got that, all right. Do abolitionists reject incremental change? One of the comments that we often get from people who are advocating for vegetarianism as the gateway is people won't go vegan overnight. Have you heard that one? I actually know that a lot of people won't go vegan overnight. Many people will. If you present the message in the right way, you can see that penny drop. Isn't that wonderful? But some people need a bit more. It can be daunting, it can be unfamiliar, it can be, I can't do this, oh, there's so much to learn, and I can only eat organic arugula from now on. So you need a bit of help, right? That's where you all come in. However we came in this weekend, we're all going, myself included, because I'm going to learn a lot from the other presentations too, we're all going to leave here as better vegan advocates. We're going to be better vegan advocates because we're going to do that most wonderful form of exercise. We're going to give ourselves a kick in the pants, okay? Before you go out, give yourself the either physical or mental kick in the pants, because we all need it. We need to get over the fact that it's a bit, we might be shy, we may be nervous, we may be not confident in that. Keep doing it. It doesn't matter if someone thinks badly of you. They'll go away. You won't be on their minds for the rest of their lives. You can afford to be insulted. You can afford to have someone shout bacon at you. Type bacon on your Facebook page. We'll all live, you know? We've got to get a little bit of a thicker skin, because this is not about us. The benefit is to us as well, both in terms of health and our general body, and heaven knows our spirit. But we are representing something, someone else, and I'm going a little bit off on a tangent right now. But this is the only social movement where it is so clear that the constituency can't fire us as their spokespeople. Mm. They can't fire us if we're not doing a good job. They can't fire us if we've turned this into a profession and a, hey, look at me opportunity. Aren't I wonderful? I know more than you do. That's shameful. We need to stop that. We are representing people who do not have a voice in our world to represent their interests. We can do this. Okay, one thing I have learned over the years watching Gary at the beginning working out the abolitionist approach is the important difference between treatment, which is what nearly every animal group works on. They're telling you we have to make more humane treatment and go to the core of the real problem here, which is use. When we teach a course on human rights and animal rights at Rutgers, and I tell my students there's something that goes on when we as humans have a problem. We have a need, we have food needs, we have convenience needs, we have money needs. We reach out and bring an animal into the problem, and then we fret about how we should treat them. What is this motion? What brought them into our world to be oppressed and be the solution of our problem? And that's the difference. We have to look at the use, because once given the use, we'll find a way to do it humanely, which is to the absolute detriment of the animals. There is no way, human character being what it is, to use another sentient being humanely. We have thousands of years of experience of that. It doesn't work. We need to go to use. That's why we need to focus on veganism and veganism and veganism. There you go. Never underestimate the importance of the individual. I'll say it again, and everyone who meets me during the weekend, you can all do this. He's a lot better at this than I am, but I do it anyway. And I talk to different people differently. So everyone in their own sphere of influence, if you're a person who people respect in other ways, for the way that they live their life, for their well-thought-out beliefs, then veganism can be part of that person that you're presenting to the world. So your colleagues, your families, that can be a little difficult sometimes, but all your professional and social interactions, you can be the person that they didn't think vegans were. You're not a weird person, you didn't drop out, you're not dressed in sackcloth and ashes, you're not pasty-faced and unhealthy because of the decisions that you've made. You're a vibrant, thinking, committed person. Just the power of numbers, let's think about this. I know it can be frustrating, it can be depressing, it feels like it's an uphill battle, it feels like you're the modern Sisyphus rolling that rock up and it keeps coming down and you try again. But just look at the numbers here. If there's 2 million, whatever the number is we start at, perhaps 2 million people in the United States who consider themselves a vegan. If everyone goes from here this weekend and this year makes another person vegan, and those two people then go next year and do the same thing. It's that wonderful power of compounding. Look, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, 128, 256, and before I am dead, we could have a vegan world. So truly, the world is vegan if you want it. Same numbers in UK. The UK movement, I have to say, I've been having trips to the UK recently, is not reaching the numbers that I hoped it would. I really hope that the UK movement, which usually had been more tied to political thinking and a different way of looking at it, wasn't just a foodie movement, seems to have come to a little bit of a halt. So everyone needs that, as I said, kick in the pants. But it's you. It's a grassroots movement. We do not need any more of the large groups telling us what to do. And no, they're not telling us what to do. They're saying, we'll do it for you. you can't do it because we're the experts. We can't ask people to go vegan because it's so difficult. Send us your $15 every month, and we'll address this single issue campaigns, which is tearing up your heartstrings. It's a disempowering model. It's the charity model. This is not charity. There are times when money cures something for vet bills and for rescue and those things. But mostly it's an education movement. That's hard if we're not normally used to doing those things. But this is not a Live Aid where sending, you know, 10 bucks on your phone is going to sort something out. That can help some situations. It doesn't change the framework that we're all working in. There we go. Exactly. So it's disheartening to see the big groups portray veganism, as I said before, as something so difficult, so extreme, that we have to understand why people settle for vegetarian. Vegetarianism, as I said, is incoherent. You know that. So it's okay to take a calf away from the mother, use the milk, the misery and the suffering, but you're not responsible for sending her to the slaughterhouse. Yes, you are. There's no coherence in terms of rejecting animal use that isn't tied completely into veganism. All right, do you want to talk about Peter Singer?
I thought yeah. I actually, when I came here today and they gave me my name tag, I thought about writing on it, Peter Singer, to confuse you. However, let me say this. In order to understand, the large groups all reject veganism as a moral baseline. Why? Because they follow the philosophy of animal welfare. Now listen to me, because this, you've got to understand this. As a historical matter, as a conceptual matter, you've got to understand this. The animal welfare movement is based on the notion, if you go back 200 years and you read the emergence of the animal welfare movement, first in Britain and then the rest of the world, what you see is this idea that animals matter because they can suffer, but animals don't have an interest in continuing to live because they are not self-aware. Jeremy Bentham, that everybody says, oh, Jeremy Bentham is wonderful because he says it's not whether they can think or whether they can reason, but whether they can suffer. Yes, Jeremy Bentham said that. He sure as hell did. But what he also said was that the cow doesn't care that you kill her and eat her. She just cares about how you treat her. So he says there's nothing wrong with killing them and eating them because they're not self-aware. They don't have a concept of their lives. They don't have an interest in continuing to live the way we do. So it's all right to kill and use them, but you have to treat them well. That was the beginning in the 19th century of the animal welfare movement. That's Singer's view now. I mean, you know, if I had a nickel for every person who said, oh, I've read Animal Liberation, you didn't read it. If you read Animal Liberation and you didn't get that out of it, you didn't read it carefully enough, because he basically says that. Peter is saying nothing different from what Bentham said 200 plus years ago. Okay? He basically says animals, he thinks the great non-human great apes and maybe dolphins and maybe elephants and other animals that we fetishize because they're, quote, like us, okay? He thinks most of the animals we exploit, particularly chickens, he's got a very, very bad view about chickens. He thinks that these animals don't have they're not forward-looking, they're not future-oriented, so they're not self-aware. They don't have an interest in continuing to live. This is the animal welfare movement. The movement has bought into this nonsense. You know, all of the large groups, why, what is the position of veganism, of mercy for animals, of PETA, of compassion over killing, of HSUS, of all of these groups? It's all the same, basically. It's, yeah, you know, veganism is a good idea because it really helps relieve suffering, but there's also cage-free eggs and crate-free pork and Temple Grand and slaughterhouses and buying, you know, animal welfare rated 3 meat at Whole Foods and all that sort of stuff. All of these groups promote that stuff, every single one of them.
None of them promotes veganism as a moral baseline. None of them promotes veganism as a moral imperative. You've got groups like DXC that basically, Direct Action Everywhere, that basically say that veganism is harmful to the animal rights movement. So they reject veganism as a moral baseline. That is why the animal movement is moving in one direction, backward. Okay? That's why when Anna says Britain is not, you know, the steam behind the vegan movement in Britain has dissipated to some degree. Why? Because there are people are buying into this. Okay? Happy exploitation. In 2005, we institutionalized happy exploitation. In 2005, Peter Singer, on behalf of number of groups, Animal Place, Animal Protection Institute, Compassion Over Killing, Farm Sanctuary, Humane Society of the United States, PETA, Mercy for Animals, Vegan Outreach, and Viva, other organizations, basically wrote a letter to John Mackey, CEO of Whole Foods, and said, "We express our appreciation and support for your happy exploitation program. This is the movement. This is what you contribute money to." What do we have? We have the idea that we should make it more humane. Yeah, it would be great if people are going to be vegan. But you know what? That's just too utopian. That's too idealistic. What we need to do is to get people to go to Whole Foods and buy animal welfare number 3, right? We need to get them to choose their level of torture. We need to get them to buy crate-free eggs and cage-free pork. And we need to make sure that they buy hamburgers made from cows that have been slaughtered at Temple Grandin Slaughterhouse. Or Temple Grandin Design Slaughterhouses. PETA gave an award to Temple Grandin. They gave her a visionary award. PETA gave John Mackey, gave Whole Foods Animal Welfare Friendly Retailer of the Year award. We have... You go to, that's my Whole Food. I took that outside of Whole Food near my house. You go, whole organic chicken, and it's got animal welfare rated system, you know, animal welfare rating number 2. And where does that come from? That comes from an organization that has on the board of directors Wayne Pacell of the Humane Society of the United States. These people sit around and come up with standards of humane torture. And then they have conferences and people give them money. And they are bringing in millions and millions and millions and millions of dollars from animal advocates who support that. I respectfully suggest that to call that bullshit is an insult to bullshit. Okay, we have, this is certified humane. This is one of the many labels. We have Britain, the RSPCA has Freedom Food. We have Certified Humane Raised and Handled, which is supported by HSUS, the ASPCA. This is PETA's giving the award to Whole Foods. We have Nathan Runkel of Mercy for Animals. Walmart announces sweeping animal welfare policy. People, use your heads. When the public sees this, when the public sees Mercy for Animals touting Walmart as being a great champion of animal welfare, what message do you think that sends to the public? I'll tell you what it says. It says, you can do the wrong thing the right way. You can exploit with compassion. That is nonsense. That is absolute nonsense. This is what the movement has degenerated to. It has become a business in which animal advocates are joining forces with institutional exploiters to promote the idea of happy exploitation.
It's a business which, for fundraising purposes, needs a continuous stream of campaigns and little victories. So these things have to be characterized as little victories, and then you can send out the, whoa, victory, you were so important in enabling us to do this. Now we're going to be your mouthpiece on the next single issue campaign. Send us your $15. Yes, I want to save the animals on the little donation slip, right? This is absolutely insidious.
And here we have Ingrid Newkirk. Now, I would say Anna and I became vegans in, as I said, October of 1982. We worked with PETA for a number of years. And it breaks my heart to see my old friend, Ingrid Newkirk, saying, Belton evidence shows that animal welfare and good business can go hand in hand. By listening to consumers' wishes, Belton evidence has set a new standard for the chicken supply industry. That's PETA, that's Ingrid. What message do you think, Belton evidence sells chicken. What message do you think that sends to the public? The message it sends is a radical, supposedly radical, I don't think it's radical at all, I think it's reactionary, I think PETA's sexist, misogynistic, and it is selling animal interests out. But if you're strongly in favor of veganism, you don't go making statements that are so pro-Belton Evans that Belton Evans puts it on their website, okay? So basically, we reject all this. You got a choice. Like a multiple choice exam I give my students. There's an A and there's a B, there ain't no C. You are either a vegan or you are participating in animal exploitation. There ain't no third choice. That's it, there's no third choice. Baby steps, this idea of baby steps. You know, I tell you, baby steps, they're for babies, okay? This idea, you know, these are not, this sort of stuff, making Belton Evans chicken more humane ain't a baby step. It's a step backward because it's encouraging people to continue to exploit animals. This idea that, you know, about people not going vegan overnight, yes, I'm aware, because I get this all the time from animal welfare people. Well, you know, people aren't going to go vegan overnight. Yes, I'm aware of that. But I'll tell you something, you always have to be clear to people with what the message is. When I talk to somebody, I say, look, you care about animals, you go vegan. If somebody doesn't want to go vegan, then let them choose what they want to do. If they want to do Meatless Monday, if they want to buy crate-free pork, if they want to buy cage-free eggs, whatever they want to do, let them do it. But let it be their choice. We, as animal advocates, should never, ever, ever put a stamp of approval on it. So this idea where people come up to you and say, well, you know what, I've given up chicken. You're supposed to put like a gold star on the forehead and say, oh, that's wonderful. I'm so orgasmically happy. I can't believe it. You are giving up chicken. And the thing is, I say, look, you're giving up chicken. So what? What do you want from me? I mean, you know what? If you believe that it is wrong to exploit animals, you stop exploiting them. And, you know,
there's absolutely nothing wrong in that instance, and the way is not to criticize the person who's taken that baby step that the animal groups say is the first and important step, but you follow it up with, have you considered going vegan? How can I help you? If their ethical light is going on, they need to be sent in the right direction. We all have a tendency to do what we think we can get away with on issues, right? If you give a clear message and you can tell people that your life isn't going to change except for the better. You're not going to go off and live in a cage and you can't touch anything and you can't use any product. The more vegans there are, the question of everything being contaminated with small amounts of animal products will change. We're only using byproducts because they're byproducts of the industry. So steel won't have animal products in its production. Tarmac won't have blood in it. Your computer won't have various products in making the plastic and all the things that move. We use it because it's cheap. So we'll find something else, way of doing it. We're very good at things like that. We're inventive people. We can manage without it. But until you hit the core industry, which is the meat and animal food products industry, nothing else is going to go into place.
And never, ever, 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 please, never tell anybody under any circumstance that it's okay to exploit animals. If somebody comes up to you and says, I've given up beef. I had a student come up to me last spring and say, you know, professor, I've given up beef. It's okay.
You weren't listening, is my...
I'll
try harder next time.
Obviously, you were listening to what I said over those 14 weeks that you took the course. That, yes, you gave up, you're giving up beef. So what are you doing? You're eating chicken. You're actually responsible for more deaths because, you know, one cow can feed a lot of people. One chicken doesn't feed, a lot of people. So you're actually responsible for more. Actually, what's interesting is the highest number of deaths per 1,000 calories next to chicken is eggs. So if you give up all meat, but you start ramping up on eggs, you're gonna be responsible for more animal deaths. So, you know, just explain to people, if you care, you stop. You don't eat them, you don't wear them, you don't use them, period, end of story. If somebody says, hey man, I can't do that, I'm not ready to do it, fine. Then choose what you want to do. You want to eat cage, you'll do it. But I ain't going to tell you it's okay. So right. If what you're looking for is for me to say, oh, that's good, oh, I'm so happy, the answer is, I'm not going to say that. In the same way that if you said, you know what, I really think this racial discrimination thing is really like not good, so I'm not going to tell racist jokes on Monday. I'm just saying, oh, I'm so happy. You know, oh, I'm so happy. You know, please let me, you know, let me get down and kiss your feet. I'm so excited that you're not going to tell racist jokes on Monday. And the answer is, nobody would do that. If somebody came up to you and said, you know, I'm sort of into child molestation, but on Mondays I'm not going to do child molestation. You know, rape, I enjoy it, but on Mondays it's going to be rape 3 months. Nobody would say, wow, that's great. They would say, stop! If you believe in fundamental human rights, you do not race, you do not engage in molestation of children. If you believe in equality, you don't ever tell racist jokes. So like that's it. That's veganism is the moral baseline. If we're going to have the whole purpose, the reason why I'm participating in this conference, in addition to my soft spot to Bob Linden, and I want to thank Bob and Ben and Michelle and the main reason why we do this is because this is the only conference in the United States of America, the only national conference, where we focus on veganism as a moral baseline, a moral imperative, something we are obligated to do right now. And so basically, you know, any eating, wearing, using puts you in the exploiter category. So stop. And what we need to do is use creative, nonviolent, vegan advocacy to educate people about how if they agree that animals aren't things, then they gotta stop treating them like things. This is really not rocket science, it really isn't. It's really quite simple in a lot of ways. Do you have any questions?
So DRC is not part of the
Well, I mean, have you ever read what Wayne? I met Wayne when he was at a law student at the University of Chicago. I was giving a talk, and he came up to me and had a discussion with me afterwards, which I didn't understand, and I still don't understand what he's talking about most of the time, because when he says things like veganism is harmful to the animal rights movement, that's a quote from Wayne, that veganism is harmful to the animal rights. He believes that direct action should be the baseline and not veganism. I don't even, frankly, I have to tell you something. I've got many years of higher education. I have no idea what the hell that means. I mean, what does it mean?
Action on what?
Action,
you know, if you've got a framework, what is the point?
How do you have direct action? Right. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, veganism is the most important revolutionary thing the individual can do when it comes to animals. Okay?
So,
first of all, a lot of this is theatrics, you know, coordinated t-shirts, standing up in a place and saying, it's food, it's not violent. I mean, a lot of this stuff seems to me to be branding. It seems to me to be, very much to be branding. But if somebody comes up to you and says, okay, fine, I'm interested in what you're saying, so what do? They don't say. I hit Wayne on the radio with Bob Linden and you know, said, Wayne, somebody comes up to you and says, what do? You don't tell them to go vegan. No, we tell them to engage in action. Well, what action are we talking about? What is the action? So that's what I meant when I said that. I mean, if Wayne believes, if DXC believes that veganism is baseline, although they keep saying that they don't believe that it's not the moral baseline, that action is, you know, that action and activism or whatever they say is the moral baseline. If that's what they think, that's fine. I disagree with that. I think you gotta be real crystal clear. You use the vegan word every single time, every single opportunity you can. You use vegan. There is nothing wrong with the word. It's a nice word.
Vegan.
Say it.
Vegan.
You had your hand up a lot. Yeah.
So let's talk about being really effective right now.
Yeah.
Exploit animals. Even it's a more pervasive exploitation than even the American economy when it depended on slavery. If we pull the rug of animal exploitation out of this economy, it will collapse in an even more dramatic way. So it's up to every vegan to stop the demand, and then there will be a natural change in the economy.
You know, you saw those numbers.
I don't think it's irrelevant to talk about a bank, because all money is dirty and contaminated by human and animal oppression all the way along.
All money is dirty money. You bank in a bank, in any bank that you bank in, is giving loans to businesses that engage in racial discrimination.
Yes.
So forget about the animals for a second, okay? You're talking about corporations that engage in racial discrimination or that engage in discrimination based on sex. So the bottom line is, until we change, we need to change. We, as individuals, need to change. We need the paradigm shift in ourselves, and then we need to turn other people onto it. Because the bottom line is, the problem ain't the bank. It is not the bank. The problem are the people who bank in the bank.
I mean, we had the whole history of mortgage redlining,
yeah,
right?
Mortgage
lenders wouldn't lend to poorer neighborhoods, which were predominantly people of color lived, and it put people in great problems of insecurity. and the fact that they couldn't get good housing and couldn't get on the housing ladder, all those things. But banks only reflect the society in that they work. We need to hold them accountable, but more importantly, we need to hold ourselves accountable.
Yes. Okay, until Lindsay comes in and demands that I get off the stage, I'll keep moving. And go ahead.
So I've been involved with DXC for a while because I felt like the message was something I've never seen anywhere else, which was a very clear message of abolition. They use the word liberation, but I felt like
Peter Singer, liberation means something.
Yeah, what it. But I wanted to say that we discuss veganism a lot, and I hear you say, we need to stop doing it, right? Supply and demand, simple economics. But I'll give you an example, and I think this is why I wanted to go to boycott veganism in the context that veganism has transformed, not into from something ethical lifestyle to a consumer movement. Okay, and in that context, we need to be careful not to use the word that others think like, oh, Usher. You look at celebrities, they turn vegan, and then they stop, right? It turns into just a diet.
No. You think I'm talking about a diet?
No, you're not. Certainly not. But I'm saying in some societies, it's conceived as just a diet. A lot of people think that it's just a diet.
So
perhaps we should be discussing the framework in which the movement works. But how does boycott veganism move us forward?
I don't agree. I don't agree with everything the article says, but I think that's
okay.
What I do want to ask though is about the supply and demand concept, because if you take an example like elementary school, when we're children, we are having chocolate milk shoved down our throats, right? Now who demands that? Do we as children demand that? Certainly not, right? Do our parents have much say or demand that as consumers, or do the schools have it?
The schools reflect the parental. Look, have you ever tried to get inside of a grammar school to talk about veganism? It's very, very difficult. Why? Because parents and kids in grammar schools don't want people going in there and telling the kids that they shouldn't be eating animal products, and that if they love babe, they don't eat babe. They don't want to hear that. So yeah, I think it is the parents. I mean, I think it's complicated. I don't want to be simplistic about demand, and I don't want to be simplistic. I'm not being simplistic about the social and cultural aspects of demand. All I'm saying is that this doesn't change unless there is a paradigm shift. We need people who think it's not just Usher, adopting a diet. It's a matter of being outraged, being morally outraged at the victimization of the vulnerable, and saying, I will not participate in that.
And voicing that.
And look, I voice it all the time. This idea, and I'm saying this is what the abolitionist movement is. I'm so proud this weekend. I've got, we're going to have a whole panel on Sunday of people who, many of whom I've never met before. They're moderators on my page. I have a Facebook page of the Abolitionist Approach to Animal Rights. And I've got, there's a lot of people on it. There's a lot of discussion that goes on. I have moderators. A lot of these folks I've never met before. They're here this weekend. And they do things in their communities. They're from India. They're from Australia. They're from England. They're from parts of the United States. And they're out there every weekend doing tabling and going talking about me. There's so many things. Ann and I are working on a new book, which, is like an abolitionist vegan handbook and stuff that we do. Everybody in this room can do something. Whether it's on the internet, or whether you're tabling, or whether you're talking to people in your workplace, or whether you're just like, each of us can be an agent of change. Each of us has to be an agent of change. The world is terrifying. Look at the situation we're facing. It doesn't require a lot of intelligence to come to the conclusion that we are in deep trouble. And we are in deep trouble for lots of reasons. One of which is that we all participate directly or indirectly in the victimization of the vulnerable. That we otherize non-human animals, and when you otherize non-humans, it becomes so much easier to otherize other humans. And so this is what we're going to talk about. What we're going to talk about tomorrow, a couple of times, is the relationship between human rights and animal rights. And one of the reasons why, one of the several reasons why we stopped working with PETA was when they started the I'd rather go naked than wear fur campaign. And I still remember saying to Ingrid Newkirk that as long as we are treating women like meat, we will continue to treat animals like meat. And yeah, I think demand's really important. We, as men, should not demand pornography. We should boycott. We should not participate in pornography because what that does is reduces women to things. We shouldn't do it. I'm not saying that pornography that portrays men is great, but what I'm saying is in a sexist, misogynistic society, pornography which portrays women has a completely different social effect because you are commodifying women in a way that you and I can't be commodified. In a patriarchal society. We gotta see these connections. You know, we gotta see these connections. We've gotta take them seriously. We need to change the world. We can change the world. We can change the world. You saw those numbers. If we have 1 million vegans and everyone just turns one other person on in the next year, we got 2 million, we got 4 million, we got 8 million, we got 16 million, we got 32 million, we got 64, we got 128, we got 256, boom, we got a vegan in the United States. So you know, we can do this. Now I realize in a social situation in which Donald Trump may be the next president, you look at this and say, "Oh God, you know, how can he, am I optimistic?" Yeah, I'm optimistic. I'm optimistic because of all of you. I'm optimistic because Anna and I meet people every single day who want to change the world. So you know what? Yeah, we are in a bit of a mess right now. There's no doubt about it. But one of the things that the whole Trump phenomenon indicates. There are a lot of people out there who believe, quite correctly, that the political process has sold them out. You know, that Washington is a disaster. Now, I don't think the answer is Donald Trump, but I mean, I think the answer in many ways is to democratic socialism, actually, is what I think, you know, and where I think we ought to go. But the bottom line is, we need desperately to change things. We can change things. You just gotta wanna do it. And you just gotta get out there and do it. Every single one of you can participate in changing the world. You just gotta wanna do it. Peace, we'll see you tomorrow.